On This Week in Enterprise Tech, the CIA and FBI wants you to stop whining. We've got the hard drives for your next NAS, and Bugcrowd is here to tell you what you need to do after a breach. Twiet on the set.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twiet.
Bandwidth for This Week in Enterprise Tech is provided by CacheFly at cachefly.com.
This is Twiet, This Week in Enterprise Tech, episode 158, recorded September 18th, 2015. Bugcrowd. This Week in Enterprise Tech is brought to you by PagerDuty. PagerDuty decreases alerting noise for IT operations and developers to ensure that the right engineers are notified at the right time. Increase your uptime and sign up for a 14-day free trial at pagerduty.com/twit. And by ZipRecruiter. Are you hiring? With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100-plus job sites, including social networks, all with a single click. Screen, rate, and hire the right candidates fast. Try ZipRecruiter with a free 4-day trial now at ZipRecruiter.com/Twiet. Welcome to Twiet, This Week in Enterprise Tech. It's the show dedicated to the enterprise professional, the IT pro, and the geek who just wants to know how the world is connected. I'm your host, Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, your guide to all things in the enterprise. But of course, I'm not guiding you by myself. I am down a man. Curtis Franklin unfortunately can't make it, but we are joined by my good friend, Cheebert. That's right, Brian Chee, the director of the Advanced Network Computing Laboratory in Honolulu, Hawaii, which I understand is underwater because of a tsunami.
Nah, it drains off pretty fast. Keep in mind, we're an island. You know, it just has to drain into the ocean.
The last time you had a tsunami warning, I just remember, because I had already moved off the island, I logged into the webcam at Waikiki Beach, and these people were piled up looking at the waters receding from the shore. I'm thinking, oh, look, this is Darwinism in effect.
Yeah, I'm especially fond of the guy in the electric wheelchair at the end of the Waikiki jetty.
Okay. Well, we're glad that you're safe, and we're glad that the tsunami did not hit the islands. But let's go ahead and jump straight into the blips. This first one goes from the FTC with love to your startups. It's time for startups to start with security first. Last Wednesday, Edith Ramirez, chairwoman of the Federal Trade Commission, came to San Francisco and addressed an audience of entrepreneurs and engineers with a simple message. In an Internet of Things, security can no longer be an afterthought. Echoing in large part her address to CES 2015, the FTC chair recognized the intense pressure that startups feel in getting products to market, but in her words, and I quote, "In a world where everything is connected, insecure products and services can have significant consequences," unquote. Along with the admonishment to put security first, the FTC published a collection of security tips gleaned from 50-plus cases that the FTC has brought against firms with lax data security policies in an effort to keep young companies from falling into the same pitfalls. Among the highlights, mandatory strong passwords and multi-factor authentication, the vetting of security policies of third-party vendors, threat assessment, and proper data sanitization. Considering the fact that the U.S. Court of Appeals ruled earlier in September that the FTC has the authority to take financial action against companies that fail to take, quote-unquote, reasonable steps to protect customer information, this seems to be the carrot to avoid the stick.
Well, the judge says banks can gang up on Target after the massive data breach. This last Tuesday, a district court judge in Minnesota ruled that it's okay for banks to gang up on Target in a class action suit, claiming negligence on the part of Target for failing to properly secure their network from hackers. Perhaps this is going to get retailers to take security seriously before we get a repeat performance this holiday shopping season.
Are you concerned with the United States government invading your privacy and possibly mitigating your constitutional rights? Well, stop whining, says the FBI and the NSA. Last week at the Intelligence and National Security Summit held at the Walter Washington Convention Center in D.C., the top officers of the FBI, CIA, DIA, NGI, NRO, and NSA took the stage to convince vendors, officials, contractors, and partners that the hue and cry against intelligence collection is really just coming from a small community of haters dedicated to poisoning public debate about national security and quite possibly being fueled by our adversaries. top of their agenda, convincing politicians and partners that the global business community could trust the United States intelligence apparatus with a golden key to crypto. My personal favorite part of the panel, when asked how his agency could restore public trust, NSA Director Michael Rogers was quoted as saying, "I don't really think we have fundamentally destroyed the public's trust."
It seems we've been blaming the wrong dictatorship. F-Secure blames the seven-year itch on Russia. In what F-Secure describes as well-resourced and organized cyber espionage group, the Dukes have been targeting governments, political think tanks, and other organizations since 2008. They're being called a methodical developer of zero-day attacks that combine their own research with that done by others. Well, I guess I can't just point fingers at communist China anymore.
We need more tech workers. That's the bottom line, according to a report from Apiro and Wakefield Research. There is a critical shortage of long-term IT workers in this country. Unlike many other studies that just looked at the number of available IT workers in the country, the new A&W report looked at how the quote-unquote gig economy was affecting IT staffing. Their results? There is a strong field of IT talent, but recruiting and retaining that talent is becoming more and more difficult as IT professionals opt for freelance work. A full one-third of HR budgets in the study are now dedicated to recruiting and retaining, and they're still experiencing an unacceptable loss of IT staff. Furthermore, the gig economy is resulting in workers who are less reliable and knowledgeable than full-time IT. The bottom line? It's a good time to be a talented IT worker.
Want to earn a cool $250,000? Start spying on manholes. Two more fiber optic cables went under the chopping block recently, bringing the total of what is being called malicious damage to 16 cuts since July of 2014. The new cuts are in Livermore and is being taken very seriously by the FBI. AT&T is offering a $250,000 reward for information leading to the capture of those responsible for the sabotage. Authorities suspect the vandals are working at night and posing as telecom workers.
Your next wireless network might actually be a swarm. At the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California, a group of postgraduate students are merging enterprise-quality Wi-Fi with drone smarts. The team is using a set of 50 customized flying wing UAVs that are built on the robot operating system and configured in an 802.11n and wireless mesh. Launched from a specialized catapult, the drones are controlled by a single operator on the ground, and their PixHawk flight controllers are connected to an Ubuntu-powered Odroid U2 that allows them to communicate with one another. Once launched, the drones form a cooperative swarm, taking their cues from a lead drone to carry out instructions. This is just a first step, but the ability to put 50 or more inexpensive craft in the air and gather unmatched real-time information is something that is being very closely watched by agriculture, resource extraction, and search and rescue. Release the drones. Well, folks, that does it for the blips. When we come back, Cheebert and I are going to go into a bite, but first, let's go ahead and take a moment to thank the first sponsor of this episode of This Week in Enterprise Tech, and it's PagerDuty. Now, what is PagerDuty? PagerDuty is perhaps the best way to make sure that your issues are handled before they become problems. A PagerDuty is an operations performance platform that delivers visibility and actionable intelligence to help increase the uptime of your apps and services, your websites, your databases. PagerDuty connects all of your systems into a single view, allowing you to see critical events across all your monitoring tools as they happen. It's an essential service if you need your software and services to always be up, and who doesn't? It has over 100 ready-to-use integration, including Nagios, New Relic, Keynote, AppDynamics, or you could roll your own with PagerDuty's APIs. You can customize it to fit how you and your team work, regardless of size or location. Oh, here's how it works. When you have an incident, PagerDuty will first look through all of your monitoring tools, filter and deduplicate the alerts, and then only will it alert the proper staff. After reducing that noise, PagerDuty checks on-call schedules and personalized alerting preferences to automatically alert the right team and the right team member. Those alerts are dispatched by automated phone calls, SMS, email, and push notifications. It's distributed across multiple data centers and multiple hosting providers, so your people will never miss an alert because of downtime of the alerting system. Now, if for any reason an alert is missed, PagerDuty will automatically escalate the issue to another team member until it is responded to. All of this means one thing. You can resolve incidents on the go while living your life, even when you're on call. A PagerDuty is trusted by thousands of companies, including Microsoft, GitHub, Boeing, Nike, and Box. Don't you think you should trust them too? Right now, you can get the right engineer on the right problem at the right time by visiting pagerduty.com/twit. That's pagerduty.com/twit to sign up for a free 14-day trial. And for as little as $19 a month, you can increase your uptime with PagerDuty. And when you sign up for a new account, you'll also get a free T-shirt. That's pagerduty.com/twit. Again, pagerduty.com/twit. And we thank PagerDuty for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. Why do you say we go ahead and jump into the Enterprise Byte? Now, this one, this is kind of interesting. I'm hoping maybe you could take the lead on this. The Department of Energy has been pretty much under constant attack. And, well, that doesn't seem to be ending. What's this all about?
Now, basically, attackers, according to a Freedom of Information Act request, USA Today found out between 2010 and 2014 that the Department of Energy had been infiltrated at least 150 times and were targeted in 1,131 attacks over the four-year span. Now, before everybody starts really freaking out, at the moment, the attacks are only against office systems. They're also successfully hitting the National Nuclear Security Administration, the guys that handle our nuclear weapons, which is worrisome. But at the moment, there's no indication they got past the office systems. Now, I will say, though, what's worrying to me is that office systems can have documentation on, say, the control systems or have gateways into the control systems for the convenience of the managers. To really see what kind of damage this can do, just look at what happened with Stuxnet, or the fact that Target had their POS system taken over because someone was careless on the office system. So this is really getting along the lines of, come on, be more reasonable. Anyway, one of the things that the story goes on to say is researchers are uncovering record numbers of industrial control system vulnerabilities. And I'm starting to really ask, gee, if we have so many vulnerabilities on networks that weren't, you know, using equipment that weren't really designed to be networked in the first place, because keep in mind, SCADA was never really designed to be networked. You know, TCP/IP didn't really exist when the first SCADA devices started getting produced. Now, Why has the industry taken so long to change? You know, the state of the art in modern network security systems isn't that big a deal. And, you know, SCADA, yeah, I understand. PLS systems aren't SCADA, but we're still talking about systems in the same genre. You know, people tend to lump them together because they inherently control what could be sensitive. It could be a refinery. It could be pipelines. It could be nuclear reactors. They should be properly secured. I'm SCADA, Ron, you agree, right? They should be properly secured. And the question I'm asking the world is, why has it taken so long? You know, cost may be an issue, but what happens if a pipeline gets opened up? How much is that going to cost us? If a nuclear reactor gets messed with, or even something simpler, say, for instance, someone starts messing around with, say, delaying stock tickers, you know, just putting a delay in, what's that going to cost? And I tell the world, come on, you know, you've got to start thinking about what's going to happen if someone gets in and messes with your gear. And in this case, I totally and completely agree with one of the bits where the FTC is talking about, be more reasonable, secure your office systems, start modernizing. You know, there's a lot of learning that needs to be done. Start investing in that. So, Padre, what do you think? SCADA Ron and some of the other people are saying it's cost and yeah, it's things. What do you think? What do you think might be the issues causing people to be so slow on adopting better security for control systems?
Well, you know, of course, you know, we've talked about this before, and it really comes down to inertia, because cost is an issue, but not so much for government work. I mean, if you need to find money for government work, and if you can express enough of a need and make people panic, you're going to get the cash. But what we have seen is there's still not really an understanding of how bad the problem is. You know, I did read this story earlier, and people were saying, well, okay, it's only the office systems. And we've got JJ did the 4884 saying if it's like the OPM hack. Yes and no. I mean, it is a compromise of computers on the inside of a traditional firewall, which means you're inside the castle. But these computers don't really have that much sensitive information, not like the network of OPM. However, something that you do look for is you could use this attack to pivot. And that's what has me most afraid, because a lot of these SCADA systems, so supervisory control and data acquisition systems, have been placed on the networks that they were never designed to be on. In fact, Brian and I, the man who's our TD right now, our technical director, we were at DEF CON this year, and there was a pavilion dedicated to SCADA devices and how easy it is to own them, how easy it is to reprogram them. In fact, Brian, we played Tetris on one, didn't we?
Yeah, I didn't do very well. I didn't know that you were a Tetris master. But
well, I mean, I'm a Tetris master, able to play a game that's running on a computer that was supposed to be controlling a pipeline, which it was very, very strange. It was a very strange feeling to see that, and to see it in the real world. That yeah, these they're trivial to hack. In fact, that device that we're looking at right now, there's a little sign there that gives you how to hack. Connect laptop here, and there's about four steps. And it's literally running a Python script, and you're in. And the reason for that is because, again, these weren't supposed to be networked. They weren't supposed to be connected to the internet. They weren't supposed to be accessible to the outside world. And now that they are, people don't understand how dangerous that can be. So, yeah, that's what I'm wondering about. That's sort of my take on SCADA, which will be it's going to take a disaster. It's going to take something really, really bad happening before there's enough political will, not monetary will, but political will, to tear all the old systems out and upgrade them.
Yeah, so one of the things I want to point out is, you know, everybody's screaming, well, you know, you can't lump nukes in with this and so forth, which is true. You know, the people that are running these systems, the ultimate security device is an air gap. But is that just sticking your head in the sand? Someday, some manager is going to do something really stupid and say, hey, I don't want to have to walk over five across campus in order to go and pull the usage statistics off device XYZ. And someone that's, you know, afraid for the job, too new for the job or something, is going to say, yeah, we can do that. No problem. We've got the technology, and links it in. And now all of a sudden we have a gateway. I think one of the things that, you know, I'm a little upset with is the industry itself is running whole hog. Let's do smart meters as the example. There's an awful lot of people running to get smart meters on the net. And I'm going, excuse me, these are modern SCADA devices, but they're still SCADA devices. Have they increased the amount of security for them? And what are you going to do to make sure that when someone says, gee, I wonder what an inverter curve does, and they go and create a goofy looking inverter curve, and all of a sudden a giant or mid-sized solar array is now no longer putting out power that the power company was depending on, and now all of a sudden they've got to scramble like crazy because they haven't started up a generator to backfill? Because remember, right now, we don't have batteries on grid systems.
You know, Chee, this calls back to the story that we covered in the blips, which is the FTC chairwoman saying, look, I get it. You want to get your products out there as soon as possible. The Internet of Things is big, and everyone thinks that the first player that really establishes itself is going to make a lot of money. However, if these are devices that you're going to be linking to the outside world, and these are devices that are going to be connected to potentially vital pieces of infrastructure, you can't slap security on as a bandage after you've released the product. It's interesting. Pre-show, we were talking a little about Adrian Lamo, and he actually put out an analysis of a story that I think went out in the New York Times when they were talking about how it's stupid to think about hacking the electrical grid. Of course you can't hack the electrical grid. And the point that he was trying to make was people are still thinking that somehow you need to blow up a nuclear plant in order to mess up the electrical grid in the United States. And he says, look, with the current level of security that we have on SCADA devices, all you'd have to do is trip a couple of critically located junctions and you would destroy the grid. You would take it down and it would take a while to bring it back up, and then you could bring it right back down. And I think once we start realizing how vulnerable some pieces of our infrastructure are, and again, unfortunately, it's going to take something bad actually happening because the theoretical never hits like in real life. We're going to live with this. Achiever, I do want to move on because we do have an exciting guest that we're going to be bringing on in just a bit. You want to talk about security. You want to talk about breaches. Well, we want to talk about it too, which is why we got Casey Ellis, the CEO of Bugcrowd, who was going to be coming onto the program to discuss a little bit about breaches, but also what do you do after the breach. But before we get to that, let's go ahead and take a trip over to VMworld. Brian Burnett and I were out there, and we spoke with our friends at Synology, and they helped us to choose the drives for our storage arrays.
I'm Father Robert Ballecer, the digital Jesuit, here at VMworld 2015 in San Francisco. Now, we all know that storage drives IT. You really can't do anything without it. But the question is, how big do you need? How much do you need? And how reliable can it be? Those are the questions that Joni Clark from Seagate is going to answer. Now, Joni, these boxes are great. Hardware is fantastic. But at some point, I need to put something in them, which is what Seagate brings to the show.
That's right. We have 8 terabyte drives we just announced today. Whole portfolio of them.
Oh, 8 terabyte. I got to ask, why do I need that? Why can't I just have a machine with a wonderful amount of bays with 3 terabyte drives? Doesn't it start getting dangerous once I get up above 5-6 terabytes per unit?
It could get dangerous if you were putting a 3 terabyte desktop drive in an enclosure like that. But luckily, we have drives that are mid-range as well as enterprise, so they're more robust than a desktop drive. I can go into detail for that if you like.
Actually, yes, let's talk a little bit about that, because there are a lot of failure stats out there, and actually one from a very popular cloud storage services company had Seagate drives as the worst reliability, but an interesting stat that didn't come out was they were using consumer-level drives in an enterprise application, which you can't do. Tell me, why are enterprise drives different than consumer level?
Absolutely. Okay. So let's start with a consumer drive, typically being used 8 hours a day, 5 days a week in a desktop system, right? And they want the lowest cost because a lot of times they're going to switch the system out after a year, maybe after 2 years. So they're going to want the cheapest, biggest capacity that they can get their hands on. So that's how they're designed. They're designed to be very cost effective, lowest cost per gigabyte that you can get. So we strip out a lot of things that aren't necessary for a desktop user. Now, if you're an enterprise user, you're going to put it in a rack mount system with hundreds of other drives. That means this drive better have the fastest heads, the best media, the most robust components, including magnets that you can get your hands on. So RV sensors are another technology that help these drives sustain high levels of performance no matter what's going on in the enclosure, all the noise, the fans, the drive seeking. These drives will sustain a high level of performance, and that's the type of drive that you want to put in a rack mount enclosure.
Now, can you take me through the portfolio? Show me what Seagate has to offer and what they're showing off here at the show.
So just to kind of give you a little bit of background, IDC did a study, a big global massive study a couple years ago. They call it the Digital Universe 2020. And what they found is they looked at all the content that was being created in the world, all around the world from different places. And what they found is that the growth rate said that in 2020, the world in that year alone will produce 44 zettabytes of data. 44 zettabytes of data in 1 year, right? Now, they also looked at all the storage, all the hard drives, the SSDs, all the boxes that were out there, all the data centers and cloud centers. And what they found is that all of it, with the exception of 13 zettabytes, actually has a home. So there's 13 zettabytes of data that's going to exist in 2020 that still doesn't have a home. So that's where these big drives come in. But I want to take you right here to this 8-terabyte portfolio. There's 4 drives. One of them's already out in the market, and that's the Archive HDD on the right-hand side. But on the left-hand side, you see 3 new, brand-new drives for Seagate. One of them is the 8-terabyte enterprise capacity drive. You and I talked about that. That's that nearline drive. You can throw anything at this baby. He'll withstand it, and he'll deliver time and time highest performance. There's the Enterprise NAS HDD. Love this drive. This baby is designed specifically for small, medium business, and I'll tell you why. We strip out all the bells and whistles of a nearline drive, and we give you the core, robust, mechanical platform of a nearline drive. But you get this high reliability, but without all that price, that nearline price. So he's going to perform like a nearline, but he's not going to cost like a nearline. Okay. Then the third one is a kinetic drive, and that one is designed to take all the infrastructure out of a server, get the server out of the way, and let you talk Ethernet to the drive directly. So he's a very unique drive, and we're still out there building the ecosystem and the infrastructure for this product today. So this is our 8 terabyte portfolio across the board.
Where do you see these growing over the next year or so? Because obviously, they're going to want to cram more and more capacity into every single unit, but we also may start to see the change of say, size formats and forms. Where is Seagate going to be pushing that?
Yeah, it's interesting because we also know that in 2020, in that time frame, there's also going to be a 20 terabyte hard drive. So do we see them shrinking? Well, we see them staying around the same form factor, but the amount of terabytes that we can pack on a platter is going to increase. And it's through new technologies like SMR, single magnetic recording, HAMR, heat-assisted magnetic recording. Even helium is a technology that can help us get there, right? So we see the form factor staying, the size increasing, but the technology inside the drive just getting better and better.
Thank you so very much for speaking with us. Now, if they want to find out more about what Seagate can do for their enterprise, for their small office, for just their large capacity application, where can they go?
Yeah, I would go to Seagate.com, and I would click on our 8-terabyte portfolio.
I'm Father Robert Ballecer. That's your next drive. Back to you in the studio.
You know, Chiebert, one of the conversations that we had in that interview was, and actually I did this after the talk as well, there's a lot of people who are scared that the drives are becoming so big that you can't rebuild an array before you can expect another one to fail. And you get into that situation where it's destined to fail. Have you hit that at all? Because I know you play with storage quite a bit.
It's getting to the point where I'm finally getting researchers to listen to me when I say data doesn't exist unless it exists in three places. So I'm finally getting them to go nearline, online, nearline, and offline. And I finally got one of the holdouts to let me archive to the cloud. And I'm starting to hear this more and more. So yeah, it's the feeling that I'm getting in a lot of research is there's a little bit of afraid that there's an awful lot of eggs in one basket.
Yes.
Especially when data is irreplaceable. So, don't know. This is going to be really, really interesting.
One of the things that did strike me, because remember, we did cover that story on, a month and a half ago, coming from a very popular web storage vendor who said by far the most unreliable drives were those Seagate drives. They were pulling them out at a rate that was 10 times higher than Hitachi. Hitachi was the best, Seagate was the worst, which when you think about which companies those are, that's kind of strange. But what they made clear, and again, we talked about this after the cameras had shut off, was this is why they're making the big enterprise push. They see too many businesses, too many SMBs, and even enterprises that are buying desktop drives and putting them into these arrays. And it's like, that's not what it's designed for, folks. You know, we don't guarantee it for that. In fact, we don't want you to do that because we can almost guarantee you're going to lose some data. So, yeah, I think we need to have another storage vendor back on. And let's do the whole nearline, what is it, offline, farline, wayline, clothesline discussion.
Well, hey, you interviewed Seagate. Let's go get them on to go talk about that Ethernet connected drive.
Yeah, I wanted to get some of that. And she's like, oh, well, you know, we can't actually show it off yet. Who knows? We'll find out.
Someday.
When we come back, we've got Casey Ellis. He is the CEO extraordinaire who's going to be explaining to you what does a breach mean to you and your business. But before we do that, let's go ahead and thank the second sponsor of this week at Enterprise Tech, and it's ZipRecruiter. Now, let me ask you this. Do you own your own business? Or if you don't own your own business, do you hire for a business? Because if you do, you understand that the employees, the people that you hire, are going to determine the success or failure of your business. They're your face. They're your talent. They're your productivity. They're the inspiration that moves you to the next level. Well, in order to get the right employees, the best employees, you have to hire the right way. And here at the end of the summer, it's the perfect time to do it. You've got the best employees coming off their summer breaks. You've got some of your competitors who are probably still snoozing. That means you need to reach out now to grab those employees before they're taken by somebody else. But you got to do it the right way. You can't just post a job and hope for the best. You need someone like ZipRecruiter. Thanks to ZipRecruiter.com, you can post to 100-plus job sites with one single click and be instantly matched to candidates from over 6 million resumes. But you don't have to listen to me. Listen to Lynn. She's a real ZipRecruiter client, and she wrote, "We have excellent results with ZipRecruiter, and we are using it to hire even more employees. Customer service is excellent, helpful, professional, and they're able to expedite service requests efficiently. It is our go-to site for hiring. Just post once, and within 24 hours, watch your candidates roll into ZipRecruiter's easy-to-use interface. They've been used by over 400,000 businesses, and you can try it now for free. Getting the right people for your company is so important. Do you really want to leave it up to chance? Today, you can try ZipRecruiter for free. Just go to ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. That's ZipRecruiter.com/Twyatt. And we thank ZipRecruiter for their support of This Week in Enterprise Tech. We welcome to the show with, actually, he was supposed to be here last week, and we messed up, so we thank him for making time for This Week in Enterprise Tech, Mr. Casey Ellis. He is the CEO of Bugcrowd. Mr. Ellis, thank you very much for being on This Week in Enterprise Tech.
More than welcome. Thanks for having me.
Now, for the folks who are playing along at home, could you just explain, what is Bugcrowd? What do you do?
Yes, yeah, certainly. So basically what Bugcrowd is it's a community of currently 20,000 security researchers from all around the world. And then what we've got is a platform that allows our clients to essentially run security testing contests. So the idea, it's called a bug bounty program. The idea is the first to find each unique vulnerability that's within the scope of the test that the client creates gets a reward for it. The more severe the issue they find, the more they get paid and so on. And really, you know, this is the kind of thing that companies like Facebook and Google kind of invented several years ago, or they made popular several years ago. What we did was basically took it and, made the concept available to companies of all shapes and sizes, adding more control to the process, looking after some of the management overhead that's involved with, dealing with all these different researchers and different things like that.
Right. And famously, we've got some of the big players here in the Silicon Valley who are running their own bug bounty programs. As you mentioned, Facebook and Google are big ones. Microsoft also has one that they've really, really ramped up. And their bounties are some extremely high. But those companies deal with their in-house software. That's what they're looking for. They want you to find things that help them with their products versus Bugcrowd. And Bugcrowd is really... You want a gathering place for security researchers to look and say, oh, hey, I'm doing research here, here, and here. These are probably the bounties I should go after.
Yeah, essentially, I think the difference between companies like Microsoft, Google, and Facebook and some of the others that are doing this type of thing in-house and the kind of folks that we typically deal with, you know, those organizations have quite large security teams. They've got the ability to deploy people in-house to become specialists in how to actually run a bug bounty program and make it successful. Not every company has that available to them. In fact, most don't. One of your articles or one of the things you were talking about before in your blips was this whole idea around the cybersecurity resources crisis that we have at the moment. This is kind of an extension of that. So what we do is get in the middle, make the process very simple for companies to run, and also, you know, make sure that it's successful for both sets of parties involved, the clients and the researchers alike.
Let's talk a little bit about that, because we had a fantastic conversation with the research team that found the stage fright bug. In fact, I wanted to play the video here, but I got lazy and I didn't finish cutting it. But one of the highlights from that talk was at one point I said, look, there's a lot of people who think you're stupid because you essentially sold this to Google for $1,337.
Yep.
And if you had just a fewer moral quandaries, you could have sold this easily for six figures. I mean, it is such a pervasive exploit, and it's going to be around forever because there are other Android devices that will never get patched. that it seems very difficult to reconcile a security researcher doing this and taking a much lower payout for the good of the people. You deal with security researchers across the spectrum, super professional and super amateur. Does that ever come up, you know, that the bounties aren't enough or that you need to increase the bounties just out of respect?
Yeah, no, definitely. I think, you know, when it comes to people that do this stuff and actually disclose the issues to the vendor instead of selling them to an offensive buyer, there's a great quote by Dan Kaminsky that runs around that, like, not everyone wants to be a drug dealer. It's like not everyone necessarily wants to engage in that type of activity. They've got an ethical framework that just makes them uncomfortable with it. And that's, you know, that's a good thing. There's enough of those around for this industry that I'm a part of to exist. In terms of the payments themselves, it's an interesting one there as well, because I think, something like Microsoft software or something like Android or something like iOS even, those bugs are more valuable to an offensive purchaser than, say, a vulnerability in Facebook or a vulnerability in, you know, a Bugcrowd client that's running code up on a website. And the reason for that is that the target space, what an offensive, you know, user of that exploit, if it's weaponized, can do is a lot more pervasive. And also that bug's going to exist for longer, as you pointed out before, because the Android issue, you know, stage fright's going to kick around for a long time because of all of the issues that Android have with pushing their updates downstream through all the different manufacturers that are in play and so on. So it's an interesting balance. I think the way we'll see it progress over time is the bounty amounts that people are paying for, like that they're offering rather, will start to increase, but then it'll normalize. Because the other thing that happens with defensive sales and defensive purchase is it only takes one person to kill the bug, right? With an offensive buyer, the whole idea is for that bug to stay alive so it can be used for as long as possible by the people who've bought it. For a bug bounty participant, a bug bounty customer, in our case, you know, they only need to hear about it once. It only takes one person to disclose it to them. And then at that point, they're able to kill it off and make sure that it's not an issue for them or their customers anymore. So that adds a bit of a dynamic to the economics of all of this.
That's fascinating. I like that. It's a combinative approach because first you make it visible enough so that the people who want to do the right thing will get props. They'll get respect. They'll get their name out there, which is what the way that they want to get paid. You make sure the bounties are high enough. So even the people who would naturally tend towards black hatting will say, well, I'll take a lower payout, but this is completely legal and I don't have to worry about anything down the line. And then you also, you go one step further and you kind of game the system. You say, look, you could hold on to it, but it only takes one person who does the right thing and releases his or her research, and then your research is worth nothing.
Absolutely. And I think for us, there's a balance to that, obviously, because that dynamic is very powerful for the people that are running these programs. Yeah, you know, we don't want to end up in a position where we're denying payment to the researchers or making it lower than it should be. So it's this interesting kind of balancing act that we're doing to try to get as much money out to them as possible so they continue to be incentivized to do this. And that they're being paid well, but also making it, you know, it's a classic marketplace transaction. It's like going down to the market and buying anything, right? The seller wants to get as much as they can. You want to pay as little as possible. And somewhere in the middle, you find a point that's fair and a transaction takes place. So that's a big part of what Bugcrowd sits in the middle of this and actually helps the two parties, you know, reach an agreement on.
We've got JJ the 4884 in the chat room, and he wants to know, how often do you update the information on available bounties? And I think the corollary to that would also be, do you know who's competing against you for a particular bounty? Do you sign up for a bounty or is it just, these are the bounties and first come, first serve?
Yeah, so there's the way to think about that, Bugcrowd runs two styles of program. So as I mentioned, there's the public programs that we run. If you go to bugcrowd.com/programs, you can see them there. We've got people like, you know, Tesla, Dropbox, Western Union, Pinterest, so on. They're companies that have basically gone out and said, okay, we're comfortable with the entire internet being aware of this program and potentially participating. But the other thing we're doing there is we're using these programs to attract researchers onto the platform, get an understanding of what their skills are. So how, you know, what are their particular talents, you know, how competent are they? How accurate are they? Are they noisy and they're just throwing stuff, or are they being, you know, very deliberate and highly valuable in how they're behaving? And also assessing the level of trust that we can attribute to them, because obviously that becomes important when you start to do private programs, which is what we do for the market that's interested in this idea but doesn't necessarily have the appetite that the tech companies have to do it publicly, if that makes sense. So that's a really interesting dynamic as well with this whole thing. It's like the reason I started the company, I ran a pen testing company in Sydney, Australia, prior to Bugcrowd starting, us getting funded, and then getting on the roller coaster over here in Silicon Valley. And really the idea was, kind of catalyzed by a number of the customers that I had looking at what we were doing and then looking at the stuff that Facebook and Google were doing and saying, that actually makes more sense. Like this whole idea, like we're being attacked by a crowd when you think about it. So having a crowd of allies to compete with a crowd of adversaries makes a lot of sense. How can we actually make that work in a way that, suits our risk appetite as a company, our internal processes and so on?
I actually want to bring in my co-host, Brian Chee Chiebert.
Sure.
Chiebert has an interesting background, which has touched on a lot of these same motivations. Chiebert, a lot of what I'm hearing with Bugcrowd sounds a lot like how you would recruit someone for espionage.
It most certainly does. In the clandestine world, the motivation is represented by an acronym, and it's MICE: money, ideology, conscience, and ego.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not just money. Sometimes you just want to have your name out there. And I've just been listening to this going, wow, this sounds just like the briefings that I used to have by various three-letter agencies.
Yeah, absolutely. It's funny because we've got relationships with people that are involved in that space and so on. That's not actually my background. I'm like all enterprise all the way, and did a bunch of hacking earlier on in life as a pen tester and so on. You're exactly right. I think, the most powerful incentive and the most, I think, survivable one over time is going to be money, because everyone has to eat. So that just makes sense. But the whole ego side of it and the whole competition side of it is a very big feature of the hacker community as well. People want to have a reputation. They want to build up their skill level. They want to be known as someone who's prominent and powerful and has an intelligence that others can learn from and so on. And they want to be able to get jobs. Like, we see people getting hired off the platform all the time. There's companies that are coming in looking at the leaderboard and saying, okay, this is a meritocratic system. These folks have actually, basically participated in a game for all intents and purposes and worked their way up to the top. They must have skills that are the kind of skills that are relevant to my organization. I should reach out to them and see if they want a job. So really what we tried to do with how we designed Bugcrowd is take a lot of the existing kind of social dynamics within the hacker community and kind of build them into a platform. It's like, it doesn't make sense for us to create a whole bunch of hoops for people to jump through if there's stuff that's already working that we can just try to appropriate.
I'm thinking of Miller and Ballecer. Brian and I actually saw them at Black Hat this year at DEF CON. And they give that fantastic, spectacular, best attended talk at Black Hat was the UConnect hack.
Yep, definitely.
And, didn't earn them any money, but eventually it led to their gig at Uber. And that's one of those things where it's like, okay, if you can play the long game here,
get
your name out there, get known as someone who actually knows what he's doing, this actually can be incredibly lucrative. One last question about Bugcrowd before we move on to restoring trust in a breach. And that is, how do you approach companies and tell them you should contract with us to look for faults in your service, your software, your products? What's the pitch? And how often do you hear, we'll just do this internally?
Yeah, sure. So the big thing, there's kind of two humps in the process, right? There's why crowdsourcing, and then there's why Bugcrowd. The why crowdsourcing piece is all about really that pitch that I gave before around the fact that you're being attacked by a crowd. You're currently competing with that by using, people that you pay by the hour, which might be plenty smart, but the economic model that you're engaging them under is never going to be able to compete with the results-based model that the adversary is using. And you're using things like scanners, which, they're good. They're definitely better than nothing, but they're never going to be able to have the level of creativity to apply to offense and breaking in that an economically motivated attacker is going to have, right? And I think, until we get to the point of having like truly sentient AI, that'll continue to be the thing. Like, we're going to be attacked by people, so it makes sense to be defended by people to you know, identify these things first. The second piece around Bugcrowd is really all about the flexibility and the ease of use, the way that we appropriate what can be seen. Like, you look at Facebook and it looks quite chaotic, or even you look at some of our public programs, you know, from the outside, it looks like a fairly kind of Wild West, chaotic type approach. A lot of what Bugcrowd's done is to remove the chaos and the risk from that and turn it into something that's quite, you know, sensible to slide into, you know, even fairly old and kind of stoic security programs in larger companies. So, yeah, that's the pitch. It's basically, listen, you know, we're going to find your vulnerabilities far more effectively than anything that you've ever used before to achieve that task. And then the way we're going to do it is a way that fits right into what you're already doing to get it done.
All right, we do have to move on because we've got about 50 sure. minutes left in the show, and we do want to talk about restoring trust after a breach. I will say, I could foresee a future of reality television for bug bounty hunts, because
100%.
It is absolutely fascinating what some of these researchers will do in order to get their work noticed and get their work ahead of the next researcher. But let's step away from that, and let's talk about something that's well, important at the same time that it's trivial, and that is the Ashley Madison hack. Now, we could use any of a number of high-profile breaches, the Sony hack, the Target hack, the Home Depot hack, but Ashley Madison is the one that's making the rounds right now. And for, again, if you've been living under a rock, then you probably don't know that Ashley Madison is a site that was created for those people looking to have an affair, and their database was breached by a group calling itself the Impact Team back in July of 2015. They exfiltrated with gigabytes and gigabytes and gigabytes of information that turned out to be customer profiles. Everything from credit card numbers to, more importantly, what they had posted on their profiles, their sexual proclivities, and whether or not they had actually hooked up with anyone on the service. Along with that was a lot of internal email that shows some of the very shady dealings going on at Ashley Madison. Now, I bring this up not to shame Ashley Madison or not to hold it up as, oh, they've been victimized by hackers, but for a very real pragmatic reason. And that is, how do you recover after suffering what looks like an earth-ending breach? Casey, let me throw this over to you. You have a lot of experience with this. This is your field. You see companies going through this all the time. For any number of reasons, they didn't pay enough attention to security, they trusted a third-party vendor that was not trustworthy, they just did something stupid, suddenly they've revealed personally identifiable information from their customer list. How big of a breach of that is that, and how do you grade it? When you look at a breach, how do you determine how severe it is?
Yeah, definitely. Look, I think the Ashley Madison thing, I mean, the way that I've been thinking about that, you know, 2013 was kind of this year that everyone said, wow, hacking happens, because that was when Snowden came out, right? 2014 was, wow, hacking happens and it happens to me, because, you know, a third of the US got popped through all of the credit card stuff that happened, you know, Target, Home Depot, and so on. 2015 is kind of like, wow, hacking happens, it happens to me, and man, it hurts, right? Because all of a sudden we've got data that's uninsurable, data that's going to cause like a swift impact on the people that are compromised, like not just Ashley Madison, the company, but their user base. And it seems to be escalating, like the personal nature of the information that's being gone after by the attackers is, you know, it's getting more personal. And, you know, I think history has shown that when these trends start to happen, they tend to continue. So it's a relevant time to be asking this question. How to survive it, how to kind of bounce back from it. Yeah, I think in Ashley Madison's case, I mean, the hackers that were going after their stuff, like the intent was to destroy the company. Like literally they had a chip on their shoulder. They became aware of some of the business practices that they saw or they were able to kind of understand about Ashley Madison, weren't happy with them. Basically told them to stop it and shut things down, otherwise they'd publish all this stuff. Ashley Madison didn't comply, so they dumped it all on the internet. Like, this was flat-out extortion. It wasn't for financial gain. It wasn't – there was no real negotiating with these attackers apart from to actually comply. And that obviously didn't happen. So I think in a scenario like that, it's pretty difficult to recover from, or it's pretty difficult to prevent once it started happening. And obviously the main thing there is to, you know, put enough attention into preventative controls to make sure you're raising the cost for an attacker to the point where they, you know, can't do that type of thing. But then in terms of recovery, like, what do you do? I think, you know, the biggest thing that Ashley Madison could have done better was to be really transparent and actually come out and say, listen, okay, here's the things, here's what we're doing, here's how it all happened, here's some, you know, level of compensation, of recovery, or whatever it is that we're going to offer to our customers. And, you know, in terms of some of the shady business practice stuff that was alleged by the attackers, or that can be kind of inferred by reading some of the stuff that came out, okay, address that stuff head on and then try to recover from it. I mean, I think they were planning to IPO next year, and now they're facing a, you know, $500 million class action lawsuit. So for those guys, it doesn't look very good.
I was speaking with Raphael Mudge at DEF CON. He's a friend of the show. He's been on it quite a few times. He's cool. The man we bring on anytime we want to scare our audience, because he always has great demos. But I asked him, I said, have you looked at the source code that was dumped? Because you could take a look at the hacking team's RAT. And mm-hmm. He had a very interesting response. He said, you know, I know there's temptation, but as a professional, I don't feel like I can look at that. That's someone else's intellectual property. Mm. I know people will look at it, but if I take what I do seriously, I have to have the level of professionalism to say this is out of bounds.
It's an interesting one with that, because I think I heard a lot of conversations along those lines. So people who, you know, you see a dump come out and people jump in on it and do, you know, analysis on the different passwords that were used, or try to do, you know, a reversing of the attack itself or whatever else. I think because of how personal the nature of the data in this breach was, it really forced that question in the professional security community in a way that was much more hard to ignore than it has been before, if that makes sense. It's like, okay, if I go through this stuff, yeah, I might find a coworker and find out stuff about them that I'm not able to forget. That might not necessarily influence anything that I do or whatever, but that's stuff that I really shouldn't know, that I don't really want to know, and maybe I'll find out anyway. So that's on a personal level. I think on a professional level, you know, it's different people do different things based on the requirements of their job, right? There's folks that, you know, it is their thing to get into this type of data and start to infer a better understanding of the kind of threats the companies face. So for them, I would say that they'd still do it, and they probably should. But yeah, it's definitely, I don't know that there's a black and white line around that one.
Chee, let me draw you in on that, because yeah, there is no black and white line. I could just as easily, as I hear Raphael Mudge saying, look, I can't professionally do that because I'm crossing a border that damages me. I can hear someone saying, look, it's a dump on the internet. It's public now. There's no way to take it back. There's no way to pretend like it doesn't exist. And if you are a professional, you have to understand what they did and how they did it, because that's knowledge you can use to help your client or help yourself in the future. Where do you fall in that?
I fall in, well, truth be told, I'm a full-time scientist. I don't have time for this. But the reality is, I don't like doing such things. I will learn tools, but I don't like looking at other people's data unless I've been invited by them to do it. Yeah. I tend to be very ethical, especially considering what I used to do. So I'm kind of leaning towards what Mudge is doing. It's not mm-hmm. mine. I don't want to cross that line. And, you know, I can't unsee it.
Yeah, actually, that was a great point, Casey. It sounds really simple, and it's almost going back to childlike logic here, but you can't unsee it.
Yeah,
if you start poking around and you find something, you can't unfind it. You know, like you said, you find a coworker's name in the database. It's like, oh, well, I forever now know that coworker's in the database. And there's no good way to have a conversation with him or her about that. It's just, this is now in my conscience. Or if I look at their RAT, and I see some of the code that they're using. Do I really want that? Do I want that muddled around in my code writing mind? Let me ask you something else, Casey. Sure. We earlier we alluded to, how do you grade a breach?
Yep.
Would you agree that this this is worst case scenario, not in severity of the breach. I'm talking about the intent of the attacker, of the exploiter. Because on one side, you've got financial gain or you've got notoriety. We've known that. We can deal with that. It used to be just notoriety. Recently, it became sort of monetized. You can get big financial gain. Then it became ideological. Your company is doing something we don't like and we would like you to stop. Ashley Madison seemed to be an extreme case because it wasn't just exposure. It wasn't just financial gain. It was, we want you to no longer exist.
Yeah.
I don't see that there's a worst case scenario.
Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, there's an asymmetry to that, that like there's no leverage. They're in a position where, you know, if you're being extorted, you hear about people getting DDoSed and, you know, they get an email saying, put a bunch of Bitcoin over here and we'll stop and whatever else. Like there's all of these different scenarios that pop up, even with credit card fraud and the stuff that happened with Target. Like that was a pretty expensive outcome for Target. But at the end of the day, the card schemes insured all of the loss that was incurred for the end users. You know, Target probably copped a fine from them, and then there's other things that they had to pay for, but you know, they can kind of work their way out of it, and lo and behold, you know, I still go shopping at Target and it's still a thing. So there are these different grades. The only one I can think of that was more extreme than this, that's widely known, was the attack on Distribute IT in Australia about 3 years ago, I think it was. It was a similar kind of extortion type thing, but what the attackers actually did is got in, basically got an understanding of where everything was. So the production systems, backups, you know, cold backups, all these different things, and then went and basically just deleted everything in one hit at about 2 a.m. in the morning and literally wiped that business off the map. Like they were no longer able to continue to function technically. Like Ashley Madison is still alive. I don't know how much longer they'll continue to be alive or what the kind of the trajectory for the company is following this. That sort of remains to be seen. They've obviously taken a fairly massive hit. but yeah, I mean, Distribute IT is gone. So yeah, I mean, it's bad. You know,
that's,
I mean,
that's more of a headshot. That's, yeah, we've wiped out your ability to do business. So therefore you don't exist. Ashley Madison is more of, it's the death of a thousand cuts. We've now put everything on the table and we no longer have to do anything, because the people who were previously your clients are going to do it for us.
Yeah, they wanted them to hurt, clearly. Yeah. And I think, you know, if you've got an attacker that's got that kind of skill set and then has that kind of intent, and really that sort of, I mean, it was malice. Like it was a malicious, like you talk about the idea of a malicious hacker, like this was pure malice. They want them to hurt. And they've obviously done quite an effective job at seeing that happen.
Right. Oh, let's pull back, because obviously we can't talk about potential after steps for a company that's dead. You know, true. Either the headshot or the death of a thousand cuts, you see where that trajectory is going. There's no real way to recover from that type of malicious intent. If they've released the information to kill your company, there's no way to take that back. But let's look at a different hack. Let's look at Sony, or no, even better, let's look at OPM. So OPM does need the public trust to operate properly. They did so many things wrong, and you've already listed a few of the things they should have done. They should have gotten out in the front of the problem. They should have been very clear of what happened and been very honest with people about what they think was affected, instead of this, well, we're going to release this, the new bad news in stages, so that over the course of the next 12 months, it just gets worse, worse, and worse, and worse. How would you, if you were counsel for OPM, how would you say, folks, stop, put down your pens, this is what we need to do over the next 24 hours. So let's back it up. You are now in charge of releasing the bad news about this breach. What would your approach be?
Yeah, well, I mean, you nailed it with the first suggestion there. I think the people that have been through a breach understand this. Like I've never, or rather I've been consulting for companies that have been through breaches, and I've had phone calls saying, hey, we think there's something going on and whatever. And, you know, you never forget your first time, right? Because I think the natural reaction for anyone who, particularly people that don't spend a lot of time interacting with people that can hack stuff, is just to completely freak out. It's like, whoa, this is black magic that's happening, and it's happening like inside my home, and I'm stressing out, and what do we do? And I think in that period of time, there's a huge you know, risk of making some really stupid decisions really quickly, because people are like, ah, just turn it all off and let's tell everyone or not tell everyone. Let's try to cover it up, blah, blah, blah. Like that. So the first thing is, okay, pens down. Let's get the people that are stakeholders in this into the same room and let's work out a proper plan for how we're going to deal with this particular incident. And then step zero before that is ideally you've planned that out ahead of time, right? So there's like, okay, here's, you know, the ideal scenario is you get your incident response plan out and say, okay, here are the stakeholders. Here are our communication channels out to our partners, out to our customers, out to the general public through the press if that becomes appropriate, all these different things. And you've actually got that there as a, okay, everyone just chill out. We're going to read through this thing that we wrote when we weren't so stressed and start to appropriate the steps that are outlined there into this particular situation. In terms of OPM and, you know, what that plan should look like, as I said before, you get the stakeholders together. The second thing I would say is really assessing what has actually happened, because it's not always 100% clear. Even if you get an inbound contact from an attacker saying, hey, how's it going? I've just owned all your stuff and you're about to have a bad day. That could be misdirection. It could be untrue. It could be just completely made up and they're just trying to, you know, mess with you or whatever. So actually going through, and hopefully you've got the tooling in place where you can look through logs, you can look through, you know, different access logs and you know, systems that you've got that are trying to detect this type of behavior in your environment and figure out what has actually happened. That's obviously the first step. But then beyond that, it's like, okay, how do we mitigate that? How do we get people involved to help us do, you know, forensics and different things like that? And then, you know, obviously how do we message this out to our, you know, our customers, to our partners, to whoever it is that's going to be affected outside the four walls of the company by this issue? Because in my mind, that's the critical thing, right? You've got your company that you need to protect, but your company only exists because of your customers. So how does this affect them and how do I protect them from the potential fallout of what's happening? And that's where it gets really tricky, because I think sometimes the balance in people's minds, you know, and you see it with Ashley Madison and their response, it was very, oh, it's all cool. Like nothing really happened. Like there's no credit card data involved. They issued that press release and I'd sat there scratching my head. It's like, no one cares about the credit card data in this breach. Like that's the least
of their worries.
That's the last thing anyone's thinking about right now. So figuring out that messaging, but then getting it out as quickly as you possibly can, obviously balanced up against, you know, making sure that the information that it contains is complete and the recommendations you can make for risk mitigation are accurate.
Now, I do want to give Cheebert one last chance to chime in here. We've been speaking with Casey Ellis, the CEO of Bugcrowd. He's been giving you some practical steps, some things that you could do in case your company suffers a breach. Cheebert, before we have to end the show, do you want to throw anything else in here from your experience in dealing with security?
When you're doing your pre-planning for, you know, my suggestion is get some people that would be affected by a breach. You know, who are the, you know, identify the stakeholders and get some opinions on what might happen. You know, like for instance, I am a victim of the OPM breach. And unfortunately, because of the level of clearance that I had, they literally have my entire life history.
But I mean, I got that letter too. And they OPM offered me a year of credit monitoring. So I'm okay.
Yeah. From a foreign company.
Because that's clearly what it's going to be used for.
Right? I know, exactly.
Yeah. I personally think, for God's sakes, talk to the people that are actually going to be affected. You know, talk to the people that are going to get hurt by it and do your planning from that. You know, I know it's not going to happen, but, you know, I'm kind of an idealist.
Gentlemen,
I think that makes perfect sense. I mean, you know, the stakeholders internally, but then some sort of trusted subset of the people that are outside the four walls to get their opinion as well. And, you know, that's a process you got to do carefully, but it makes a lot of sense to get that input.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm actually very happy that China has backed up my employment records from government service. So if I ever need it, I can always go over there and get myself a copy. Gentlemen, I want to thank you both for being part of this panel. This was actually a really fun discussion. Casey Ellis, again, CEO of Bugcrowd. Do you think we could invite you back at some point? I'd love to have you back on a panel, maybe with a couple of other security specialists, maybe get a couple of other bug bounty folks on to talk about the different philosophies of bounties. Would you be willing to do that?
I'd be delighted to.
Fantastic. I do want to give you some time to go ahead and tell people about Bugcrowd, about where you're from, about what you do. If you could please, in as much time as you need, tell them where they can find Bugcrowd, where they can find your bounty program, and what would be the best way to contact you.
Certainly. I appreciate that. So Bugcrowd.com, Bugcrowd.com is our site. Most of the contact details for how to get in touch with us if you're looking to run a program is there. Obviously, we've got a bunch of security experts that are able to take your call or to respond via email and really tailor a solution that's designed to get you the most effective output from this type of program. I think the thing to really call out is to be very clear that this is not just a tech company thing anymore. We've got plenty of customers that are running privately that don't look like Facebook or Google or some of these more cutting edge companies that, you know, are happy to take greater risks with how they approach IT security. What we've done is we've taken some of the innovation that they've come up with and packaged it up in a way that's very safe, it's very controlled, it's very secure, and it fits into what you're currently doing today. So, you know, get in touch with us through that. In terms of researchers, you know, sign up on bugcrowd.com as well. If you go to bugcrowd.com/programs, you can see the public programs that we're running. There's a ton of stuff up there. If you can, you know, for instance, if you've got someone who owns a Tesla who's going to let you plug a Cat 5 cable into it for a little bit, you can go hack on that and see if you can find a bug in the car like Charlie and Chris did. And, you know, what we have around that is a team of people that are really focused on making sure that your interactions with these companies are successful, but also that, you know, you guys are learning, you guys and girls are learning how to get better at this stuff. There's a ton of folk on the platform that they really love to learn and teach some of their techniques, some of their skills, some of the mindsets that make them effective as people that can do this type of thing. The other place that's really interesting to go is forum.bugcrowd.com. That's where there's a lot of discussion around tooling, different techniques and tricks and tips and exploits and so on. And that's good for people on the researcher side as well as on the customer side. I think having security teams and engineers go there who aren't necessarily doing security research just to understand some of the things that are going on, some of the ways that people are thinking about breaking into stuff is a really helpful thing. You know, ultimately, the problem that we're trying to solve here, you know, we're a million people short in terms of the cybersecurity resource crisis, according to Cisco. Yeah, so what we need is an army of people and a way to really efficiently connect them to this problem set of identifying vulnerabilities in systems before the bad guys do. And that's exactly what Bugcrowd does. So, yeah, bugcrowd.com. Follow me on Twitter. I'm always up for chatting. I'm definitely quite verbose on there, so I apologize in advance to everyone or anyone who decides to follow me there. And I look forward to talking to you guys more.
Okay, so we loved it. Thank you very much for your insight, and thank you for being part of this episode. Of course, we also want to thank Cheebert, Brian Chee, our geek in paradise, the man who gets squashed by hurricanes and washed up by tsunamis. Sir, what are you up to, and where can we find your work?
Actually, I just jumped in with a bunch of DEF CON peoples. Shout out to Smitty Halibut and the gang. We just put together a scholarship so that Ahmed can go to DEF CON and show off his clock and things like that.
Very
cool.
And,
you know, I think that might be a good way. We don't go and fill our lack of IT professionals or engineering professionals by slapping handcuffs on them and taking for jail just for bringing show and tell. Come on, people.
Absolutely.
We need to encourage kids like that, not discourage them.
I think Ahmed is actually going to be at Maker Faire next week. So if he's there, we're definitely going to try to get him on camera. And the Jesuits, my organization, we actually do have a high school in the Dallas area. So, you know, Ahmed, if you want to go to a school that likes people who are smart, I'm just going to throw that out there. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for listening to This Week in Enterprise Tech, for using up another hour of the best dang enterprise podcast in the universe. That's according to 9 out of 10 members of the Hacking Team. I want to thank everyone who makes this show possible, of course, to Casey and, of course, to Cheebert, but also to the people here in the Brick House who makes the show go. That means Lisa and Leo for letting me do This Week in Enterprise Tech. It means Karsten Bondi, my super producer, and of course, my absolutely brilliant, fantastic, really nice guy of a technical director, Mr. Brian Burnett. That's right, the cranky hippo. Brian, can you tell the folks where they can find you on the Twit TV network?
Well, thanks for that toss, Padre. But yeah, they can find me working with you on Know How every Thursday at 11 o'clock. We've always got a few crazy projects going on. And you can follow me on Twitter at @cranky_hippo.
Folks, we want to thank you for watching This Week in Enterprise Tech. I'm Father Robert Ballecer, just reminding you that if you want to know what's going on in the Enterprise, just keep quiet.